Hello and welcome to SDSC Live, a live video production of San Diego State University News Center, your source for SDSU news. Today we're going to be talking about the Coalition Warrior Interoperability Demonstration, or CWID for short. I'm your host, Lorena Nava-Rogero, and today I'm joined with by Jay Anacito from Space and Naval Warfare Systems Center Pacific, and by Eric Frost, who is an SDSU professor and director of the Immersive Visualization Center, or VisLab for short, where we are presently broadcasting from. And just to let everyone know, we are taking live questions today. So if you're on Twitter, please use hashtag CWID. Again, that's CWID for any of your questions that you want to tweet, or you can email them to me at lnava, L-N-A, V as in Victor, A, at mail, M-A-I-L, dot SDSU dot edu. So now, let's get started. What is CWID?
Well, the Coalition Warrior Interoperability Demonstration is an annual event sponsored by the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. It was initially created so that our joint services, the Army, Navy, the Air Force, and the Marines, could work together. Now, once we solved some of those problems, that turned it from JWID to CWID. It then started taking into consideration all of our allied partners, NATO, our Canadian allies, the Brits, and New Zealand and Australia as well. That formed the coalition. And besides that, when we respond to any situation in the world now, we very rarely go on our own. We go with a coalition. After 9/11, that coalition was expanded to include any federal, state, or local agency who was a stakeholder in homeland security issues. So the technologies that are explored are for those venues: the joint environment, the international coalition environment, and then our multiple level state, local, and federal agency environment.
Very good. Now, Eric, as far as SDSU, we're only one of five sites in the country and one of many internationally. What's SDSU's role in this?
Thanks, Lorena. Yeah, we're one of 20 sites internationally, and that actually fits San Diego really well because of Provost Marlin's leadership in looking at things internationally. This really, really fits with what we're doing, and also with President Weber's ideas of being an engaged university. Engaged in the region here, we are engaged with the military, we're engaged with real problems that are out there, and CWID is really about how do you actually use technologies to help solve real problems. And there happen to be a lot of problems in the world, and if we can both be involved in those, and if we can involve our students, many of the Homeland Security students have been involved in this, that actually gives a training, a connection, and especially something that's been really neat for us is the connection to the SPAWAR people and to people at NORTHCOM and Dahlgren and other parts of the world.
It's interesting that you mentioned the real-world problems that you're trying to solve. What are some of the scenarios that you've kind of demoed this week with the different technology? Could you describe a couple of them for us?
Sure. Well, the first thing we do when we develop the scenario, and all these technologies are tested against the backdrop of a series of homeland security, man-made and natural events, wildfires, an explosion on Broadway Pier, a radiological dispersion device, an explosion at Qualcomm Stadium, suspicious vessels that we track with radar and sometimes squawk their AIS signal and sometimes don't, and a number of other events. But what's most important is we create these events with the cooperation of the agencies here in San Diego that go to our planning conferences and say, this is important to us. And obviously wildfires from our experiences in 03 and 07 are very important to the first responders in San Diego. And so that was our 9-day scenario. That was 4 days of what we dealt with and what these technologies helped us address. We had an explosion at one of our evacuation sites. We injected that scenario to support a technology that said, no, we don't want that to be a terrorist bomb. We want that to be a regular event because we're working with other types of responders that will come in, like the gas company and the power company, and solve that. We had another event like the radiological dispersion device, or commonly known as a dirty bomb, went off on Broadway Pier. The reason we had that was because it's a jurisdictional nightmare. Once the politicians decide who's going to take the lead, we have a number of agencies that need to share and exchange information. That's what some of the technologies here are demonstrating, is how can San Diego Police, how can the Harbor Police, how can Naval Region Southwest Law Enforcement, how can the U.S. Navy and the Coast Guard all share information and visually look at it. It's very complicated when you're on radios and all speaking at the same time. when you, and working along with the Visualization Center, when you put it in something that was born out of, say, a simple Excel spreadsheet, then to a database, now to an HTML product where everyone can visualize it on the internet, it makes it a lot easier for folks to make decisions.
It's interesting that you mentioned the internet, because one of our questions actually asks, can the technologies being demoed at CWID be accessed by anyone? Since it's on the internet, we all think public access.
Yes, absolutely. That's one of the big things that's changed over the years for us, and why SPAWAR and the United States Navy have decided to work with academia in the school, is because we see that instead of having different clouds of classification levels, which we've used in the past, we can now safeguard information within the internet. The technologies are available mostly over the internet, but a lot of that, of course, is firewalled so that only the right folks have access to it. I'm not 100% certain if our technologies can be seen over the internet at this time. Can somebody else answer that question for me?
Yeah, one way maybe to answer it sideways, though, is that a powerful part of what the internet has actually done is it's really changed the paradigm of how you actually respond. And a way of doing that is you can build a tool to put it on the internet, but you're not building the internet. And so what CWID has really done is a massive paradigm change of how can you actually build tools where you're building it to enhance a major capability in lots of different kinds of ways, with maybe the wired internet or the satellite internet or a variety of ways that it can be there. But the idea is how do you actually build things that can be small extra tools, but that are massively capable. And the reason they're capable is because we have this global connectivity and also expertise of all these different people that are using it that know how to get in and how to communicate and to do it in multiple different kinds of ways.
It's that leads to our one of our next questions that we've gotten is, what are some of the common gaps that happened when it comes to communicating between agencies during emergencies? Is the internet really helped fill that gap, or are there other technologies that you've been looking at this past several days during the demonstration?
One way, be a simple way of saying that is how you communicate with somebody is actually a very broad term. So one way you can communicate that really effectively is show somebody a picture. And then with the picture, somebody can see all sorts of things there that's what is important to them, what they might do with it, that isn't what you might type to them with text. And so one of the major things that a lot of the software programs do is they combine textual information that's about very specifics, but also with things that are maps, visualizations, video, and then people can look at it and they can communicate in a huge number of ways. Say just a camera looking at an emergency evacuation center. You don't have to say everything's okay. The person can look at it and go, things are okay. And it's very straightforward. There is no need to communicate with somebody sitting there constantly saying something. And so trying to find the tools that very easily put it up, or another tool during a fire. Where the fire is a huge difficulty, and if people knew where the fire was, they can take appropriate action. And so one of the ways that things are, a number of the tools here are, how do you actually provide the key critical information that people need of where is something, where are the ships, where are the people, where is the fire, where is the plume going, and then ways that can go out, and by building it on the backbone of other tools like Google, Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, which you're using, and that's the world is changing, and we see Iran as an extraordinary example of that. The world has changed because of Twitter. As 140 characters in a row, you go, that's impossible. But it's very simple, and it's because people use it in new and creative ways. And CWID is very much about trying to help enhance that creativity and ways that are linking groups of people together, and they go, that actually works. And if it works, they'll go do it again, because they've seen it actually works. And the demonstration part of this is huge, because people are really kicking the real tires, and they're going, this works. And so they will go out and do that.
It's good you mentioned Twitter, because I just want to plug it one more time. If folks, if you want to send in real-time questions right now, please use hashtag CWID. Again, that's hashtag CWID or pound sign CWID. Or you can email me lnava@mail.sdsu.edu. Now, another question that we've actually gotten is, looking at the different types of technologies, and you mentioned Twitter. Has there been new ideas that have come out of CWID in testing things, and we should really add that capabilities to that technology.
Absolutely. One of the technologies we're looking at, and one of the things the doctor started to explain, was how do you visualize things? Well, what we have is a GPS tractor, or a Blue Force tractor, as the military calls it, and it's a device designed to be carried by first responders. There's a lot of them available, and they rely on the GPS satellites. One of the prototypes that we're looking at here at SeaWood this year is one that switches to the cell phone network once it loses its GPS satellite. Why is that important? Well, you may be able to track a first responder up to a building, but say you go to a large structure like one of the buildings here at San Diego State, and you have your geospatial representation of that area, and if you can drill down far enough, you lose that GPS signal, that first responder goes into that building, you can track him inside that building. Even though he's not receiving the GPS signal, he still can be tracked, and just visually you can look at it and know where he's at. That device can also send out a real quick burst message saying it, hey, I'm okay. And he also has a hot button on there that says, hey, I've got a problem, send additional help.
Mm-hmm. In the same kind of a way of just the same thing that Jay was talking about, by having some of those devices and some of the people here trying to put that device into their mapping, people went, well, the software doesn't really work yet. And so one of the things that's taken place in SeaWid is people have actually finessed a number of the pieces of software so that it actually shows a bunch of things off that didn't no one even knew that they wanted to, like using Google Latitude and going, that just came out, but now, wow, this does all these different kinds of things that didn't work last week. And it's because people sitting here looking next to each other, like the example of the ice cream cone in 1928, where the ice cream person sitting next to the waffle people, and you put the two together and ice cream cones were born. And very much the same thing is taking place here, that very specifically, people looking at each other going, oh, this would actually work. And so of doing that, there have been several groups that have figured out, oh, I can just take my piece and your piece, and as long as they're standards-based, they actually fit together just fine.
Mm-hmm. Now, as far as first responders go, we talk about first responders, but there are people, you know, at the higher levels of command that are going to be making quick decisions based on some of the technology, too. Can you kind of describe a little bit of that role as well? Because I think first responders are a big focus, but there are people making big decisions in moments like this.
Well, I think one of the things you got to look at here is that by using the internet, we all have everyone on the same network. That's one of the biggest problems we've had with radio communications in the past, is not everyone's on the same network. A lot of the communications device that we're using that the internet take advantage of already exists, cell phones, other types of PDAs, and other small communications devices that can broadcast the internet. A lot of technologies now are IP-based. We're trying to take advantage of that. The technologies that the decision makers are looking at are taking that information and quickly assessing it. Now, in some cases, it's also being able to do analysis on that information because all that information is literally streaming into the decision makers at a rate that it never has before. And a lot of the lessons we've learned in the military, where we get so much information in, it's almost information overload. So it's now being able to analytically process that, being able to visualize it with geospatial representation, maps, or other types of things that are easier on the eyes, helps you put the picture together and see it more clear very, very quickly.
Is there anything you want to add?
I think that's a very neat way of for the person that's a decision maker, they know they're having to make do this or to do that. And if they can put it in a geospatial context, in a simple way oftentimes that most people are good at, they're among the 500 million users of Google Earth. They know what that is, they know what it looks like, they're familiar with it, and flying in and looking at it and putting the decision there where it's now in three dimensions, and they see that one point versus the next, that there's a major hill in there. Right away, they're making much better decisions because the information that's coming in is contextualized of where are the fires, what can you see, why can't these firefighters see that, and because you have topography that's being shown. And so the representations that are going in are really being done to say, what does somebody actually need? And SeaWid is really that requirement. What does somebody actually need to make a decision? And there's a whole bunch of information they don't need. And to try to say, how do I pick out the what do I need to make that decision versus this is extraneous information that, yeah, that may be interesting later on, but right now the price of that house actually doesn't matter versus whether there's somebody in that house. Mm-hmm. And so trying to look at what you would do and with each one of the scenarios, it's different. And putting all of those together becomes really important for what SeaWid has done, because it's sort of how would you respond to a perfect storm? And the fires, as an example, they happen mostly, say, September. September is also the beginning of flu season. So you look at, put all those pieces together, and SeaWid is, how do you actually make a decision when you have a complexity that isn't just this thing and we're all good and, you know, give each other a high five and we still don't know how to do the complexity. This is how do you do the complexity, and that forces people to make decisions that help them make the decisions for real when they actually come down the road.
Mm-hmm. We have a question from a viewer. Are these technologies and demos funded by Homeland Security grants in San Diego? I don't know who wants to go first or have
Well, I can speak to some of that. Mm-hmm. A lot of the technologies that are demonstrated throughout the 20 sites internationally and the 5 sites here in the United States come to us from international industry. We have technology from Italy that was born out of their experience in military maritime domain awareness. In other words, tracking ships at sea. Well, they took their expertise in that and transitioned it to the commercial and private industry. The same with the Italians. I don't know if I mentioned that. We have Italian and Finn. We have 2 trials that have done that. We also have a lot of American industry. Large companies get involved with this. There are also a lot of small companies, a lot of startup companies get involved with this. Now, as far as the grants from Homeland Security money, I'll turn that one over to Dr. Frost.
Sure. Kind of to follow up a little bit with what Jay said, as many of those companies get involved, they're paying their own way for all this. So they're showing it off to say our stuff works, which is kind of like, I'm going to stick myself in a place that I'm being tested, and I'm teaching somebody else who's then going to speak for me. So it's not a trade show in that way. On the San Diego State side, the Viz Center is just volunteering their time to be involved in this. And so it's something that sort of the group of people are coming together to say, how can we benefit the... So it isn't something that, oh, there's CWID money, so there is no CWID money in that context. The point of it is sort of this other people's money idea in the government of how does the government actually find really good solutions without putting a whole bunch of money into it, where the having the support of SPAWAR to actually manage and to put it all together, that's appropriate to put things there, to tell companies, if you want to be involved, it's on your own dime.
Well,
go ahead.
I am certain that we do have a few technologies that are funded by what they call SBIR, the Small Business Initiative Research Funding, and those, like again, are small technologies. They receive grants, federal grants, to take it one step farther. And that's kind of what CWID is. It's taking that technology out of the laboratory, out of their perfect environment, and bringing it here, which is outside the lab. And instead of having something just demonstrated for us, we're having our role players, our individuals from the San Diego Police Department, Naval Region Southwest, our Royal New Zealand participant, our Coast Guard guys, we're using their skill sets to test those technologies. But that's because SBIR said, we think this is worthwhile, so let's go ahead and move it up.
And then groups like DHS can actually benefit from that because it's DOD that's actually doing that paying. DHS is benefiting and all the other agencies, Department of State, a bunch of other people are benefiting from it, but they're not the ones that are supporting it for most of what's been taking place here.
Just a quick reminder, folks, your last chance for questions. Again, if you're on Twitter, use hashtag CWID or email me at lnava@mail.sdsu.edu. We do have another question here. You talked about that there are a lot of different companies coming here to demo their stuff. Who has visited the lab this week to see the demos in terms of the guests, and what's the breadth of interest? I personally noted a lot of people have just been coming through here just to check things out.
I think there's a huge array of people that have come. Some people senior. We've had several admirals that are here who are coming in to look at what's actually going on. What are things that actually work? You know, and that's a very simple kick the tires. What works? What doesn't work? There are clearly a number of people that would be users in the first responder community. There are also a number of people that are companies that are coming in and going, what's the competition in a way? Where in a very neat way you're going in and saying, wow, this works. And this works in a way that, several of these do Google Maps, Google Earth, Facebook, and you go, oh, those are ways that building on that and putting it together, here are people that have found solutions. There are other people that are coming in here that are very much looking at how they would solve problems internationally, and they look at some of these pieces and they go, you know, this would actually really work, this wouldn't work. And so it's a huge array. Some of the high school students from SPAWAR have been through here, and very interestingly, because they are Twitter users, Facebook users, MySpace users, as a lot of this stuff, they look at it and go, you know, this is real straightforward, I get it. I mean, I get it, because it's their world, and there's the world that also people going in as sailors and people in the Army and Marine Corps and Air Force, There is a technology capability that's extraordinary among young people, and what they're then seeing is, oh, here's how I could actually use my creativity and these tools and actually accomplish it. So there have been people here from very young to extremely senior.
I can give some specifics. We've had folks from our local command, SPAWAR. We've had industry has been represented by SAIC, has been out here. We've had folks from the Regional Terrorism Threat Assessment Center, Navy Special Warfare Command, United States Coast Guard, their disaster preparedness folks. Let's see, who else? Customs and Border Patrol. And a lot of students have come through as well.
And a lot of the Homeland Security students that have been here and helping, a lot of them actually work in those Homeland Security agencies. And so this is also very much something that adds to the educational part of things, where people go, oh, here are possible solutions to different kinds of problems that a number of them are using in a variety of ways.
Very good. Well, I think that's all the time that we have for today. But thank you both again for joining me today to just talk about this event. It's such a big event, and it's just really great to hear about all the great things that all our local companies and the university is doing. So, Eric and Jay, thank you so much
for
joining
Lorena.
Me.
You're welcome. Thanks for having us.
Oh, you're welcome. Again, you've been watching SDSU Live, a live video production of SDSU News Center, your source for SDSU news. Thanks for joining us, and we hope you click in again soon.